What the fuck is up, America? It's time to talk about CEO. This shit's gonna be pretty fun. You guys ready for it? It's gonna be some good times and where the fuck are we this weekend? Daytona. It's gonna be some good times in Daytona this weekend. A lot of people are saying they don't have pools out. That's not true. Pools are out. They're like preliminary, I guess, in the pool assignments. So we'll look at pools A1 first. Obviously, the A block, as you see labeled at the top there in red, is at 12 noon Friday. So this is great because now I know that Street Fighter doesn't start till noon on Friday, which means I can sleep in. Then there's the 2 o'clock block, and then 4, and then I think it ends at 6. Yeah, so then the next set is 10 a.m. on Saturday. So at 8 p.m. Saturday, it's cutting off. They're always two-hour blocks. If you don't know how tournaments work, then modern FGC tournaments, the way their schedule is always in two-hour blocks. All right, so the last pool section is 10 a.m. Saturday, and then we're into the top 96 already. So that's pretty crazy. That means starting at noon on Saturday, Street Fighter will already be in 96. That's pretty early. Yeah, they have to run early because of the wrestling show and the Street Fighter League. Street Fighter League, I believe, is, yeah, you see right here, it's 8 p.m. Capcom Fighters has made their finals at 1 p.m. for the last, like, three or so North American premiere events. Have you guys figured that out? I think it's because Capcom Fighters has decided that 1 p.m. is the best time slot they can fit that is internationally good, right? It makes the most sense internationally for everybody to tune in. And it's a very international game, usually. There's a lot of players from Asia in the top eight, especially, and also Europe. So I think that this is a strategic move by Capcom to be like, hey, we want to put it in a time slot that's good for all of our audiences everywhere. It used to always be the last game, regardless of entrance, except for at Combo Breaker. Imagine if Gutex wins CEO. All Gutex has to do is defeat the Cool Kid, Ceroblast, Damascus, and Gotchkun, the Capcom Cup champion, in bracket. This is just a pool bracket. He just has to smoke them all in his pool. He'll be fine. Cero getting out in winners, you heard it here first. This is a hard-ass pool, dude. So MOV is not going to go, by the way. He's in one of these pools. I saw his name already. He's in the pool with Commander Jesse, right? Yeah, this one. He's not coming, apparently. He got sick. It's three out. Yeah, I figured because when you look at... It's a top 96 and not a top 64. A1, this is noon Friday, the very first pool. One thing about being the noon pool on Friday is it's a little later in the afternoon, which I think helps a little bit for international players. But you always have to think about how jet lag will affect players, particularly from outside of the U.S., especially early pools. If it's like 10 a.m. and shit, that is when it gets very hard, I think. So A1, the big heavy hitters, is probably Ceroblast. While Clint entered Street Fighter, I haven't seen him play in a while. Didn't he play Rashid? Damascus, who I think is coming out to play do some Dragon Ball. And then Gotchkun is obviously the big one, Capcom Cup champion, and the Cool Kid. It's probably the biggest threats in this bracket. Cool Kid, Gotchkun, and Cero are probably the projected three to make it out, I would guess. And what order? I have to assume Gotchkun is the favorite, but you never know. Cool Kid is really solid. He could do it. So, bracket A2, we've got... Naomon is actually very solid. You know, the thing about the Japanese players that I feel like more and more of them... We're deep enough in the game now that I feel like more and more players are traveling to far CPT events. Smug is in this bracket. Shax is in this bracket. Jesus. This is a tough pool. C Boogie down. Pool A3. Dogra is in this bracket with Hurricane. Marine. Oh my god. Shinakuma level 2. Rushdown's in this bracket. Oh shit. Zaf is there too. This is a tough bracket. Pool A4. Haitani is in this bracket with Neon Samurai. Oh my god, this bracket is tough too. Haitani making it out in winners. I mean, he's the favorite there for sure. I think Neon or Samurai beating him would be not an upset, but is probably not what's supposed to happen on paper. Sakagami, I'm not familiar with. There's not that many Japanese Balrog players, so I probably have seen him play, but I didn't recognize the name. Damn. All right, so pool A5. Probably the big one to watch out for, Machibo. Wow, Nephew's in this too with Killer Cam. The big one is Machibo. I think his play lately has looked really, really sharp. You can tell that Machibo is one of those players that was always extremely sound. You know what I mean? Like, he could always do it because his background in fighting games is so strong. Like, you know, he is a threat for that reason. But I feel like he now looks like a player who knows Street Fighter V really well. He's like a Street Fighter V player. Like, he's very familiar with the game. And what's it called? I think that his play lately has looked really, really strong. Most impressive to me is that his whiff punishment game and anti-air game are superb, which is to be expected. That's something I think you would probably think about him characteristically of what's it called? Being like really solid on the ground. And his anti-airs are... it doesn't make sense. His anti-airs are super clean. A6, we have Commander Jesse. Goichi is in this bracket. MLV is sick, apparently, so he is not going to be making it. NL is in this bracket as well. So MLV not making it is unfortunate. He's been playing a lot of Karen lately. Maybe that's a sign. He got sick after he started playing that character. I would guess probably the favorite here is NL, maybe? NL... Yeah, I would guess NL is the favorite. Jesse has probably a good chance to make it out in 3-out, but that's what I would guess. John Ding has been playing Street Fighter V for a while. Yeah, he's pretty solid. B1 has Johnny, Justin, Chris G. Pumper Jam's part of the Jam family, so I'll give him some love for that. Wow, in Third Eye Vision's there too. You know, the big ones here are really, to me, that are scary is Johnny and Justin. I think... Johnny had a really, really good performance earlier on, but the last like two events I've seen him at, he hasn't looked as hot. I wonder how he'll perform here, especially against someone like Justin, who is so prolific. I feel like players like this will always have some kind of strategy or studying that will come into a matchup like this, you know? What's interesting to me about Japanese players in particular is I feel like when they sit down and practice for a specific player or matchup, they always come in with like some strategy or something that will get the job done. They're very, very good, I feel like, at boot camping a matchup or against a certain player. They all sit down together and like they're like, what should we do to beat this motherfucker? And then they just start studying and they like think about it and they're like, well, how do we defeat him? And then they come up with a strategy or formulate a plan together to defeat that player. It makes sense. You can see it, right? I feel like for that reason, if I see a US player make top 8 and they play like any Japanese player the next day, they play Fujimura, I'm like, Fujimura has like a 90% chance of winning if there's a day break before the next day. Anyway, on the topic of B2, Fujimura is there, Dual Kevin is there, John Ding in this bracket with K-Brad, Noisy Child, Sherry's in this bracket, what the hell? I think probably the favorite here is Fujimura for sure, right? After that, I think Dual Kevin probably has a decent chance. He's been playing pretty well lately. So yeah, and I think K-Brad's looked better in the last like few times I've seen him play too. When Zidane made top 8 in 2015 for Gear, Rion stayed up just to have a line conference call with all the Kai and Leo players. That's what I mean, dude. This motherfucker was ready. He gathered a conference table of people like this was a national threat. He gathered the UN and was like, what are we going to do about this? Pool B3, we have Abao, Filipino Man, P-Chan, Rob TV, Tokido. Oh boy, Big Toke. This is it's one of those pools. I don't know. I feel like Rob's been playing pretty hot. He's looked pretty solid lately. That's a tough person to beat, though. Tokido's record, I don't know. Yeah, I mean, he's obviously extremely prolific for a reason, although not unusual for him to lose in pools. He's one of the easiest players to find footage of against your character or your player and then study. But I think for that reason, it's hard. The thing about Tokido is, though, is like, man, when I watch him walk around with Akumas, I don't want to call him like Mr. Fundamentals, but like, you know, when I watch him walk around with standing jab and standing medium kick, I just feel like that shit is so good with this character and so simple that it just like, it just depends. As long as everything else is like on point for him that day, as long as he looks really solid with like his anti-airs, he's not like getting smoked on the ground super bad, and he's not just getting dunked by pressuring Cool Kid 4 times in a row and wake up when he has critical art, you know? All right. B4, Daikokugo. Knuckle Doo Dang, Mike Yaru. This is a bracket that I expect. It's interesting. I don't know how Knuckle Doo's going to be performing. I've noticed that he's been streaming. Oh, wow. I didn't even see Vega Patch at the bottom. Oh, shit. I almost missed that. Yeah. Okay. Well, the thing about this bracket is I would expect, actually, Daikokugo, I feel like, never performs how I want him to perform. So, yeah, I wouldn't be surprised if Vega Patch takes the pool. I was going to say I'm not sure about how Knuckle Doo's been playing lately. He's been streaming a lot, and he's been playing a lot of games and stuff. But I feel like this year's Knuckle Doo hasn't been as, you know, as dominant as previous years. Vega Patch could definitely do it. He doesn't have lovely matchups. Well, actually, I think he's fine against Guile. It depends on who do picks. He's great against characters with four frame buttons for that reason, right? So yeah, I guess we'll see. Especially because there's not a lot of Fang players to play. So at least, especially in the US, there's not very many left these days. Most people have given up the character. So a lot of people's matchup experience is like outdated. B5. Kainu and Bonchan. Was here. Another Hurricane. Not the same Hurricane, but another Hurricane. Yeah, I imagine Bonchan is the favorite here, although he could lose to a couple of players in this pool. I haven't seen JWoww travel as much this year, but yeah, he is typically the World Warrior. The one thing that I've noticed about Bonchan is I feel like he believes more in Sagat in matchups that is important, and he will pick Karen when he has to. He's in that position now where, like, before I felt like he played Sagat, and then when he would be like, I don't think he can do it, he just picked Karen. But now, to me, he looks confident in both of his characters. He's like, I will pick Sagat in this matchup. I will pick Karen in this matchup. And I think because he looks more confident to me, I like the way he's playing lately. B6, Book. Yeah, Book plays some Street Fighter. He used to play Ken. I think he plays Akuma now, if I remember correctly. Henry Sen, Hot Dog. Henry randomly beats people. You never know. Luffy, PR Balrog, no good citizen. You know, the thing is, you guys laugh about Golden Sen. He randomly beats people all the time, I'm telling you. Not even randomly, he just beats people all the time. Dude, Hot Dog was grand finals of the DreamHack in Texas. And then he got smoked by Punk 6-0 or 6-1, I think, in the finals. DreamHack Dallas, top 8, cracks me. Every time I think about it, I just think about the commentary. It cracks me up. I can't think of any commentary I've ever listened to where the people wanted to be so far away from the mic. Neither of them sounded like they sounded like they were 1,000 miles away. It was cracking me up. B7. Someone said B7 is weak. What about it is weak? Are you crazy? It has Sien, Storm, Kubo, and Just a Kid in it. Yeah, this pool is pretty solid. It says Just a Kid with lol face. Anybody who posts lol in like every other word, like, you don't have anything else to say? Dude, could you imagine Drake in the front row with a Punk jersey on clapping and shit? Could you imagine Drake getting in fucking Tokido's face calling him trash like he did at the finals? We're on C1 now. Daigo Uma Juarez, who's been streaming a lot. This motherfucker, man. The other day, I was like, oh, let me see what Daigo's streaming. I turn it on. He wasn't even playing Fire Emblem, which is the other shit he always plays. What the fuck was he playing? He was playing some random ass game. I was like, what the fuck is Daigo doing? This shit was cracking me up. Pikmin, was that what it was? I think you're right. I was like, whatever you say, Daigo. You just, yeah, play some Pikmin, dog. He's chilling, man. He's like, oh, CBT is happening. Yeah, let me play some Pikmin. He's like, it's fine. They can't knock me out of top foot, whatever it is. I'm qualified, bro. Let me just chill at home and stream on some Hitbox. It's a good choice. Mr. Crimson, Princess Slim, Daigo. This is a solid bracket. Daigo, I imagine, is the favorite to make it out, but Crimson could do it. Princess Slim probably could too. This bracket C2 is Strider, Dan Slip, Gentleman Thief, Kazunoko, King Birdie. Jeez, this is not an easy bracket either. I imagine the favorite here is, I don't know, actually. I was gonna say Strider, maybe? Kazunoko, I don't know that this is his focus, especially with the Dragon Ball Tour just being announced, but he could still do it. He's got like a real basic bitch Ibuki, but I think it could get the job done. Yeah, Danslip could do it too. That matchup is not excellent for G either. Strider lost to Shaohai at whatever it's called. What's that thing called? Combo Breaker? Guilty Idom, Trash Box in this bracket. With FGC Jesus, yeah. Trashbox is a strange fellow to me. I firmly believe Birdie is like the best character online, by the way. Pool C4, we've got Mena and Ryusei. Those are the two ones that stand out to me. Squall, Tyrant's in this bracket too. Tyrant's coming and he's entered. I did not realize that. I got to imagine the favorite is Mena or Ryusei in that bracket. It's three out though. I think Mena is probably maybe the favorite. He looked pretty solid at Combo Breaker. Dogra, I guess, actually does have a good record against Mena now that I think about it. But he has a weird style. I think, you know, I think Wayne is getting to what I was just going to say is I feel like he's very, very good against the matchups that are common in the DR, and they have a couple of good Urien players there, so it makes sense. C5, CJ Truth, who got fucking top player late registration privileged in by Jabali himself. So if he defeats California's own JB, I'm throwing a fucking flag on the field. Micro Nuke? That name sounds familiar for some reason. Simple Tricks is a landmine. Who does Simple Tricks play? Hoshinoa? I'm not familiar with this player either. For C6, we have Bombito. Mandrake. Oh shit. Punk's in this bracket. Punk's the favorite here, I think. He won Daigo's online tournament. Are you talking about Kuano?
Yeah, I remember seeing that online tournament
that Daigo had on his channel. I'm curious about this bracket. My prediction is that Kuano will probably get a game on Punk, and he might mirror with Karen. Last set of pools, D1 Densetsu here. Dr. African. Angry Bird in this bracket. Tachikawa in this bracket. Valoran in this bracket. Damn, this is a fucked up pool. D2 has GLB, GamerB, Terrence, Twisted Rivera. GamerB is probably the favorite here. I didn't know GLB was coming to CEO, actually. I didn't even see him at Combo Breaker. Chris ECH with Mojo, Momochi. Oh, boy. Damn, that's pretty tough. Momochi's probably the favorite. If it's three out, those are the three I expect to make it. The Anthrax is there in which bracket? Oh, and yeah, here with Chris. This bracket looks tough to me, man. I got to tell you that. I feel like the pools that always end up the hardest are not the pools where it's like the number one seed for whatever bracket it is. It's always like the pools where you end up with like a lot of the middle seeds crunched into one, you know? That's always the tough one. When there's like four players that you're like, fuck. Even in this one, I think Momochi is the favorite, but it's, you know what I mean? Those are the kind of brackets where you're like, fuck, I don't know what the hell is going to happen in that one. In pool D4, what, Demon of the Mist? What kind of Naruto-ass name is this? Mago in this bracket with OG on. Phenom. Stupendous. Latino Flava. If he doesn't show up with a clock on his around his neck, I don't know if I can trust him. In this bracket, I don't know what to expect. D5, we have Corey Bell. Mono, Poke Chop. People always get surprised about Poke Chop. He played a lot of Street Fighter 4. So yeah, he's solid. Masako in this bracket. Toy there as well. Damn. That is not easy. This is a tough bracket. Yeah, it's probably Sako's pool. Although, you never know, man. I think, like, Sako this year, because of the changes to Minot, is more potent to dying before getting to really activate and make his V-Trigger effective. So, I think Toy could probably beat him. He has a pretty good chance. Mono actually has a decent chance, too, I think. It's not a lovely matchup, but you'll be all right. D6, the big threats, probably Psycho, I guess. Shine, Shanghai, damn, they're all stacked at the bottom of the bracket. D7 is Big Bird, Itabashi, Zangief, Ramasama. He's been doing pretty well in Street Fighter lately, I feel like. This bracket is probably a Itabashi versus Big Bird. You guys like Shine over Shanghai? I feel like lately Shine has looked pretty solid. G1, we have Ice Effect, Lud, Snake Eyes, Takamura. Bro, I haven't seen Snake Eyes play this. Where the fuck has Snake Eyes been? Where the hell is Red Bull at? Someone get Red Bull on speed dial. Where the fuck has Snake Eyes been? I feel like he's been to 5 tournaments in the last 3 years. He's building the Gaffro pad. Jesus. G2 has Alex Myers, El Chicote. Oil King, realistic. This is probably an Oil King bracket, but Oil King is hard, I feel like, for someone like Chicote or Myers. The thing about Oil King is that he's so unpredictable and scrambly. And both of them were going to play characters that have to get in and press against him. And there's going to be matchups that he's familiar with. That's the troubling thing. Chakotay has been, I feel like, looking really sharp, though. So we'll see. Three outs are important for something like this. Oh, boy. Marvello, Otani, Problem X. Where's Lord Problem X? I thought he got upgraded. This is a Problem X pool for sure. Pool G4 has Brian, John Takeuchi, Lazunoko. Oh, Jesus. Ricky, Washed. Nightmare Effect is in this bracket, too. I imagine this is a little Johnny Tack bracket, although Brian could beat him, I guess. Pool G5, Chris Wynn. F-Word is entering. I did not realize. That means somebody's going to... I fucking... Man, F-Word, you're a son of a bitch. All right. F-Word, Moke, Nemo. Damn. Fight Amir. That sounds familiar to me, too. G6 has Anti, Broly, Fudo. This is probably a Fudo bracket. Up to Snuff is pretty solid, though. Wow, Veggie, right at the very end. Veggie sneaks in there. I'm mad at this motherfucker F-word in the bracket. These goddamn Europeans, man. You notice, you look at the brackets, you see Tyrant in the bracket, Damascus in the bracket, F-word in the bracket. These motherfuckers, man. It's cool. I get it that you guys are entering the tournament. That's tight. I like entering tournaments, too. When you motherfuckers, man, if I have to wake up and do 10 a.m. commentary because F-word is in this fucking pool, and, well, they can't schedule him for commentary because he's got to play at 10 a.m. And if this motherfucker makes it out of his pool and I got to commentate fucking semis or some shit because this guy's missing, I swear, if him and Tyrant, I swear to God, I got the curse. Well, you guys don't understand. I have the 10 a.m. commentary curse. And him committing to this fucking 10 a.m. shit, this is going to get me smoked. You also just need to enter the tournament. I feel weird about entering any tournament that I'm being paid to commentate. You know what I mean? That to me seems like a conflict of interest. I'm not saying I would make top anything. I'm just saying I feel weird about it. TOs need to enter too to just knock you out and beat you up. That's a good idea. That's pretty funny. I haven't looked at the DBFZ pools yet. It is a Tenkaichi event. And the interesting thing about the Dragon Ball pools is like nobody knew. So Dragon Ball, they said CEO is part of the tour, but they didn't say what kind of event it was going to be, whether it was an auto qualifier, whether it was this or that. So I think a lot of people probably is like, you know, the mindset was like, we need to attend this event because it's going to be on the tour. We don't know what's going to happen. So I think a lot of international players are like, oh shit, we got to go to the CEO event. Turns out it's not even a Saga event or anything. So they were like, well, it was a Saga event last year. And so I think a lot of people are like, fuck. They were planning to come out here for this, and now it's not a Saga event, so they don't get as many points as if they would have attended a Saga event, which is unfortunate. Yeah, I see Hook's name. It is not a Saga event, no. Motto entered the bracket? Oh, shit. Odd Future was in the Street Fighter bracket, too. Speaking of which, Tyler's new album is very good. I don't know if you've heard it. Yeah, they changed the DBFZ system to points instead of Dragon Balls. There is auto qualifiers, and there is an LCQ. But there is a point system as well for 12 people. So top 12 in points will make it in, besides the auto qualifiers. I just wanted to look for international players, really, that were traveling in. I figured that most of the U.S. players that we expect to be in this bracket will be here. Like, I already see Apology Man. I saw Hook over here. I see Sage over here. You know, I see, like, the normal. We expect LK. I expect most of the normal U.S. players that are going to travel out here to be here. I see Toshikawa in the bracket. I saw Kazunoko in the bracket. We point out Fenrich is in the bracket right here. I expect that most of the players the normal Japanese and U.S. players that we expect to see here will be here. Wait, Soji's in that bracket? I did not see that. Where's LK's bracket? Damn, you're right. Soji's down here. Haven't they played before? I feel like they had. Maybe I'm misremembering who played who. Where's Bombabon at? He'd be at the top of one of these brackets. Probably. Is he in one of the beginning brackets? No. He is coming, though. I know that. This is like one of his first U.S. events since signing, right? Bombabon's right here. Motto's coming. There's a lot of Japanese players coming. Sub? Oh, I didn't realize Subatomic Sabres is going. Nice. Sub is very, very good. I'm mad at this guy, Sub. He never fucking tweets anything. He's so quiet on social media, but he's such a good fucking player. And he always does these. Dude, we were sitting there at Wednesday Night Fights. We were watching him play casuals. And I was saying, like, you know, he's one of the only players that I'm like, man, your combos are fucking good. Like, you do really optimal routes in, like, every scenario. So then he got this random-ass hit and sparked up, and he did the craziest TOD I've ever seen. It was, like, some mid-screen TOD. He used Vegito Assist in it, and it popped him off for, like, some, like, hold vanish, perfect attack. It was, like, the craziest TOD I've ever seen. I was like, what the fuck are you doing? Why didn't you tweet that shit? And Sub's like, oh, you haven't seen that one? And we're like, no, none of us have seen that. He's like, yeah. I didn't think so. I was like, what the fuck are you talking about? Because I'm talking about Carter Gray dropping the 570 bits. Thanks very much. Yo, is Obama still around or did he pass out? I got to ask him how old is that kid that goes to Fighting Tuesday that's coming to Evo? Okay. There's a kid that goes to Wednesday Night Fights whose name is Stealthy. And I think he's like, I don't know how old Stealthy is. I would guess like 14 or something. I was going to say, we got to set up the grudge match. Children fighting to the death. Oh, Sonic Fox is in the last pool. Is Abigan here? I didn't see his name. Oh, wow. He's right here. Yeah, I missed him. I was looking up and down for JPN, obviously, for location. Tyrant entered Dragon Ball, too. I wonder if he's just coming to play games. I don't know what he's commentating or not. Smash Player Light? I didn't see his name. There's a lot of Smash players that were playing Dragon Ball. A lot of, especially the Ultimate players, a lot of them were playing Dragon Ball. Kuba is going. Or maybe he's just signed up. I don't know. I know he was trying to get money to go. We saw Odd Future in the other bracket, and OFWGKTA is in this bracket. Are they different people? Sounds like a Quackbot situation. That's pretty funny. I was there. What an event. What an event that is. Oh, man. Yeah, I didn't see Goichi in Dragon Ball, but we saw him in Street Fighter, so I know he's here. We have the normal players. We saw Dogra in Street Fighter, Goichi, Kazunoko, Tachikawa, but then a lot of the other really strong Japanese players that are coming out too. Yunus should probably be good. What else am I excited for? I should probably look at the schedule, actually, and see what I'm going to be able to watch. The big one for the weekend for me is always where top eights are going to be. So what is the Sunday schedule? Sunday schedule is 11 a.m. top eights. Oh, the arena is different from everything else. I see. Street Fighter is at 1 p.m., the same time as Undernight. Fucking hell. Tekken 7 is 10 a.m. Ooh, yeah, I'm going to be at CEO this weekend. 10 a.m. Tekken 7 in the arena? Damn it. Why the fuck is it 10 a.m.? What is in the arena? Only four games, right? It's Tekken 7, Street Fighter, Mortal Kombat, Smash Ultimate. Guilty Gear has an 11 a.m. slot. Yunus has 1 p.m. That sucks that these two are at the same time and in different places. I'm not going to be able to watch Undernight and Street Fighter at the same time. And I don't even know if I'm doing Street Fighter Top 8 or not. But if I am, then that sucks that I'm going to miss Yunus completely. That's too bad. This has been an early look at the pools. We can probably take a look tomorrow at these projected brackets, because they'll be a little bit more locked and loaded, and we can think about some of the matches for there. So as far as I understand it, there is, yeah, four sections of this top 96 that are projected. Now, obviously, these are projected brackets. They aren't final, but it's just something to keep in mind and maybe think about when you head into the weekend. Some of the matches you could see, like, you might be like, let me zoom in one more. You might be like, oh, yeah, so out of pools, we're going to have Smug versus Fujimura. These two fucking play every tournament. It's crazy how they ended up in the same, like, section of semis again. Or maybe Strider versus Gamer vs. Strider versus Fujimura for top 24. There's some interesting matches that could come out in some of these early post-pools matches. It is also a three-out system, so there's a lot of players in the loser side. The loser's side is going to be stacked because they have to cut through all of these extra players because of the additional player per pool that's making it out. It's all guesswork based on the Smash GG algorithm and also based on seeding, I would guess. You know, the seeding, even if, let's say these two players have played each other like 10 times and one of them has always won, if that player who has always lost is the higher seed, then this will automatically assume they move on past them. It doesn't take into account errors. It doesn't take into account any of that. It's just projections based on the current seeding. So there's four sections of top 96. In this section, we have Gachikun. This is all projected, by the way. In this section, we have Gachikun Johnny up on top side. Let me get this ready so I can start writing. Gachikun, I think, had a pretty tough pool, but I think he was the favorite. Daigo Angry Bird could be a very interesting match out of pools as well, actually. I'm not sure. Daigo has really been diving deep into learning hitbox more and more and trying to develop more techniques and stuff for it. So I'm kind of interested to see that match. One thing that's interesting to me about Angry Bird is that I'm impressed with his success against, like, international competition, considering that a place like Japan has some pretty solid Zeku players. So it's not like they're unfamiliar with what the character does or how to play the matchup. It's just he's that good. And he has a different style too, which helps too. Smug versus Fujimura. This is a common matchup. These two end up playing against each other a lot. Smug has kind of tried to play G and it hasn't worked, so he switched to Balrog. So he's kind of been back and forth about what characters work against Fujimura. But usually I feel like he has the most success against him with Balrog. And he has beaten him a couple of times. That's not a matchup that is one-sided, I think, for Fujimura. Bottom side is projected to be Strider versus GamerBee. I think this is an interesting match to me. I'm not sure how GamerBee is going to do against G. I don't know that I've seen him play against a lot of high-level G. And Strider just lost the other week to Xiaohai back at Combo Breaker in the Cammy matchup. So this one I feel like is kind of 50-50 in my mind. I don't know who does better here if they end up playing each other. How does Cammy match up against G? I thought last season she was very good against G. But the thing is that, you know, you obviously have the ability to throw off his anti-air game with your air approach options, and you can bully him on the ground. So the thing about that matchup is that although I think Strider's G in particular is really good at playing the ground game, whiff punishing and buffering with lights and like standing light punch, standing light kick, The problem is that the threat of the air approach means that he can't just sit there and play his normal ground game. So I think like just having that in your arsenal is very, very powerful against this character. But she also explodes when she gets hit. So I think she has a little bit of a better control kind of in the mid screen or in the neutral. But like as soon as he gets any momentum, she can just die. Especially if she doesn't have meter. Loser side, these are some of the projected matches. We probably won't look through each and every one of these, but some interesting ones we'll probably highlight. Man, they have Vegapatch losing, actually. I'm surprised that he's not projected to make it out of winner side. I think he was in the pool with Knuckledew and someone else. Neither of them are projected to make it out on winner side. They have Samurai, I guess, making it out on loser side and projected. Same with Chris CCH. These two, I feel like I've seen play a lot, and I feel like usually Samurai has the edge. We're looking at DDR pools. Hell yeah. Rob TV, they have projected making loser side. Hurricane, Goichi. Goichi's pool, I thought, was... I think he was in the Strider pool, if I remember right. I'm not sure. Mostly when I look at these losers bracket matches, all of these will probably be in a completely different order because it depends on who makes it out of every pool, and it's going to be shuffled around by this too. So I'm probably not going to dive that deep into it, but it's interesting to look at the losers bracket and see that all these players might end up having to fight to make it out into the top 24. Like, for instance, we're not going to see, like, Samurai and Chris CCH and whoever made it out of their pool make it out of this, right? Not all of them can make it this far in the bracket just because they'll end up having to play against each other. Angry Bird over Johnny, I don't find that that's surprising on here. Johnny, I feel like I'm surprised that it has him projected up here, although I guess, like, he's had some pretty good results at, what was it, NCR? This is a tough qualifying match if that's what you have to do for top 24. Johnny versus Angry Bird. All caps, what are you looking at? All of it is on the screen right in front of you. Instead of hitting the caps lock on your keyboard and typing all of those letters out, you could have just looked at the screen. Yeah, so H3, this is the second set of the top 96. Oh, this is the section with Knuckledew. Okay, I see. Projection is not random. It's based on seeding and like past results. So like if you plug in, it doesn't matter who it is. If you put, I don't know, Johnny Donuts as first seed and Tokido as second seed, if they play against each other in the brackets, Smash GG will say, well, Johnny Donuts is first seed, he moves on. So that's what we're looking at. So Dogra, it has him making it out of his pool in winner sign. I remember his pool not being easy, actually. Anyway, so Dogra, Tokido, I think usually favors Tokido, although Dogra's beat him in tournament before. I think that was last year. Idom Omochi, I'm very interested to see Idom play some more against international competition. He had a dope combo breaker, and I feel like he's one of those players that like you really have to have a lot of high level lore experience to even have a chance against him. And even if you do, it doesn't make it any easier because he can still just destroy you even if you have it right. Titani versus Knuckledew making it out if they make it out on winner side. That's an interesting match to me. I feel like Knuckledew is in this phase where he's at Ultra Street Fighter 4 Knuckledew. Back when he decided not to only play Guile anymore, and he was like, you know, I'm gonna play some more characters. He's kind of been doing that since the game came out, but he's in that point now where like he's really working on these secondaries, like trying to grind his G, trying to grind his like his Cammy and his Mika, and like really get them up to like the level that they need to be for tournament play. And Haitani has just like, you know, he made the switch to Akuma a couple seasons ago, and since then I feel like he's been like back and forth about how solid he's looked, but lately I feel like he's been playing the best he's ever played. And his walk down, like the way he walks you down, is fucking terrifying. Machibo is another player who's really hitting his stride right now and crushing it up against NL, who I feel like is also in that point where he's kind of coming to terms with like switching characters and really settling into feeling, looking and feeling probably pretty well about how he's playing. Loser side, it has, we see Cool Kid and Terrence down in this section, Kazunoko. This is some pretty wild matches. Yeah, it has Idom losing to Momochi, so he would get dropped down here. They has Justin in this section, loser side, Cerablast. I remember the pool that had Cerablast in it was pretty difficult. Justin and Myers in this. This is a three out, so there's two in loser side from each pool. Shax, they have making it out on loser side. Losing to Dogra, this in the projections. And have him over Tachikawa, which I think is probably true. Tachikawa has been trying to play a little bit more Street Fighter, but I imagine with the announcement of the Dragon Ball Tour again, he's maybe switched focus back towards it. We'll see. What I'm curious about, actually, I didn't look. Does anybody know if Moke entered Dragon Ball now that the tour is back? He was really focusing a lot on Street Fighter. Wow, I don't see him. He's actually, it seems like he's maybe not playing. Yeah, his sponsor wants him to focus on SF5. I see. Takamura. In the next section. This is the I section on Smash CG. Takamura, they have him going down to Oil King. I don't know about that match. That's probably 50-50 in my mind. Takamura has been playing super well lately. Problem X versus Mena. I feel like they've played a few times. That's interesting. Problem looks fantastic lately. I really like the way he's using more Bison VT1 and dumping his meter to get tons of chip on people. I think that's a cool idea. Phenom versus John. That's interesting. I don't know that the last time I've seen them play. I feel like if it's a scrappy match, I think Phenom might be okay in that, actually. I guess we'll see. But John has looked sharp this CPT season. I thought John has looked like he's looked really in top form. Yeah, Phenom is playing a lot more Karen. I feel like he still has that kind of scrappy, like scrambly style that makes him very good, even though he is playing more Karen these days. Bonchan JB has JB projected winner side out of his pool. And then Bonchan as well. Bonchan has looked great this CPT season. Really comfortable on both of his characters, which is important because before I thought he looked comfortable on one character or another. Now I think he looks really great on both characters. And also, Bonchan is one of those players that, like, when he has, I think psychologically, if he's prepared for someone, he's very hard to defeat. Bonchan has a good chance of defeating John and anybody else on this part of the bracket and moving towards top 24 / top 8. Itabashi in this section of the pool and loser side, they haven't making it out. As well as it seems like Storm Kubo, Kuwano, that's interesting. I'm curious to see how he does in pools, actually. Luffy, Moke, Toy has a good chance. I think Toy is an underrated player. He's very solid. And just the kids down here as well, that'd be interesting to watch. Xiaohai, he's always around. That's the thing about Xiaohai, is I feel like as soon as you forget about him, he just shows up. That was him like last CEO, right? I remember last CEO in the finals. I feel like Xiaohai is one of those players where you start to forget about him for just a second. For just a split second, you're like, where the fuck is Xiaohai? Oh, there he is. He's in top three of the tournament. It's always like that. You can't count this guy out. Xiaohai will always show up. Sokko versus Nemo. These two have played a few times, and I feel like Sokko had the advantage last season, although I don't remember seeing them play this season. Hot Dog versus Punk. Punk beat him at DreamHack Dallas, and also he's looked very, very, very solid lately. Sokko versus Punk. That'd be interesting to me. I think that has a chance to be... I don't love that matchup for Manat as much this season as I used to, but I think it's still pretty solid. This is definitely one of the reasons last season that Karen struggled quite a bit, is because characters like Manat were so powerful against her, right? But I think Punk is pretty good in the matchup, all things considered. Shine versus Fudo, that'd be an interesting match. I think I'd like to see that. I don't know if they played before. I feel like this sounds familiar in my head. Fudo, who's looked great this season, he's had like three or four finals finishes, top three finishes at events already, and like premieres and ranking events. Cian versus Big Bird. Yeah, I think Big Bird's pool, I thought he was probably the favorite against Cian. I feel like these two played at Seam maybe last year and Big Bird won there, although that was quite a long time ago and Cian was a Shadowverse player at the time. Hot Dog is from Hong Kong. He's got the mustache. Let's see. It has CJ, Akainu, Danslip, Brian F, Mago. Lots of really good players in the loser side of this, actually. This is a pretty stacked loser section. Chakotay, I remember having a pool that was pretty doable for him. Maybe it was Momochi in there. Snake is down here. It has him projected. Wow. Nemo Mago again would be great. They played over in China, or was it Taipei? I don't remember which. And Mago beat him, actually. And he was like embarrassed, kind of. Or was it Korea? No, it was before Korea, so it must have been Taipei. Okay, so this is top 24 to top 8. Yeah, because top 8 is right here, and then for loser side, top 8 is down here. If Problem X versus Bonchan is going to happen right, you know, if they're playing their semis here, and then Problem X versus Bonchan is Sunday morning, then I would think, like, okay, well, with time to prep and everything, Bonchan probably has a better chance than usual against Problem X. I was talking about this yesterday, but Japanese players are usually very good at sitting down and formulating strategies together on how to defeat whoever they're playing against, particularly non-Japanese players. But because there is no break and it just goes right away, I think that gives probably the nod to a player like Problem X in a matchup like this. Same thing with something like Punk Fudo. If this matchup were to happen, that would be really cool to see. So the projected matchups, Gotchkun Fujimura. Yeah, I mean, this was a Capcom Cup match. These are two super high ranking, high profile players, extremely strong. Right, masters of their characters. This is a really good match if this ends up happening. And it's a top 8 qualifier. Problem X versus Bonchan. I would love to see this. Particularly, I imagine Bonchan plays Karen. I feel like he's gone back and forth in that matchup, but it's got to be Karen, I think. His Karen has looked really great lately. Tokido Machibo. I think this is one that Machibo could win. That's what's interesting about this. Machibo definitely can win this match. This is very winnable for him. But I would love to see Tokido versus Punk. Consider, like, if he, you know, defeats Fudo here, which has been kind of back and forth, right? He lost to him at Evo Japan and then defeated him at NCR. So Punk could definitely do it. And then that sets up potential Tokido Punk in winter semis. Although if they both lose, it's Machibo and Fudo. Machibo drops here. Fudo drops here. It could be a potential Tokido Punk in first round of top eight loser side. Yeah, Fudo's birdie is great. So loser side, these are just some projected matchups that could happen. Cien versus Angry Bird. And then they have Cien taking it over Angry Bird. And then Cien Sako. Winner plays against Bonchan because he loses up here to Problem X in the projected. It's the importance of a big bracket like this. With an event this big, you have to think about the stamina of players and stuff as they have to charge and march through a long loser's bracket. Seven sets to get to top eight or whatever it is. I think Machibo can beat Tokido. I don't think that that's too crazy of a prediction at all. I mean, I think that's a super reasonable match for him to win. I think everybody who's been watching CPT this year would probably agree. Machibo has looked awesome. He's, I think, a top 10 player, not only on the leaderboards, but probably in just how he's performing. He's looked great. I think that's what's cool about the CPT season this year is that although you have some of the usual suspect, in particular the top four, this is pretty, you know, this is kind of what we expect. I think what's cool is that after the top four, we have Cien, who's performing great this year, right? Last year, he was a little, not really the same, especially later on when he was focusing on playing Shadowverse and other stuff. But then you have Machibo, who's near the top, which is awesome. Strider is back up and playing very well. Momochi's having a great year, which is, I think Momochi is very fun to watch. Obviously, he had the Evo Japan W, and then since then, he's been playing well. You see JB, he had the Texas Showdown win. That's like his first big event, so it's cool to see him up there. Angry Bird's traveling again. We saw him have that awesome performance at Capcom Cup, and everybody really likes Hizeku, but now it's like he is at these CPT events with everybody else, which is really cool to see. So there's like a lot of players like that where I think like maybe this year it's kind of like the shakeup. Takamura is another good example, actually. He was playing last year too. Didn't quite qualify for CPT, but he looked really, really great. But now he's traveling a ton, and it's cool to see him there. Just as cool as Elix Soul dropping the Twitch Prime. Thanks very much. It's cool to see like some other players in like this year's CPT looking better than ever and having like a striking chance at Capcom Cup when usually we're so used to seeing the same kind of players, you know? Fujimura Problem is also a match I really like watching because Fujimura Problem is between two players who are like masters of their characters. And so when you get to like a match like that, it's always so fun to watch because you're not going to see Bison versus like Ibuki at that level very often. Two characters that can do so much cool stuff too, especially with Bison having VT2, like the options that you can set up with both of these characters are really cool.